Good evening.
Greetings.
We are the proud parents of the bride. On behalf of Peter and Rebecca,
Genevieve and Ward,
we want to welcome you all to this happiest of occasions. We're grateful to all of you who have come from near and far to celebrate with us and to be together in this room to share their joy.
All of you here are our nearest and dearest and have helped shape Peter and Rebecca into the wonderful people they've become. For the role you all have played in their and our lives, we give thanks.
We would also like to thank all those who are making this evening possible. Grace, our wedding planner extraordinaire, who made the wedding dreams a reality. The musicians from the business and the wonderful staff here at the MCA.
We appreciate their efforts to create this celebration.
One of the things we love most about Rebecca is her huge heart. Rebecca is a devoted and faithful to her family and nurtures her close circle of friends, some dating from kindergarten, and many of whom are here tonight. On her bedroom door at home, she has a sign that says Rebecca's room. And underneath that, everybody welcome. While their siblings might argue they were occasionally blocked from entering, Rebecca models a respect and acceptance of others that calls us to be our better selves.
We've also admired her for her drive, not for her driving. That's another story. However, the ferocity and determination sometimes make parenting a challenge. She was an intense competitor on the sports field, cycling through soccer, lacrosse, badminton, cross country. Is there anything else to add to that list? Before settling on mock trial as her favorite sport. She honed her intelligence, quick wit, and poise through state and national mock trial competitions, and has left the amateur leagues and now turned pro in her current role as a litigator.
More importantly, though, she wants a life full in all its dimensions, and it is Peter who has completed this picture. Peter and Rebecca met through the miracle of online dating. The couple, as the New York Times puts it, were introduced through coffee meets bagel. Peter and Rebecca share some obvious commonalities. Williams College alums, walking the same streets of Hyde Park before they met, a love of cooking, and a commitment to their faith. As we've come to know and love Peter, we've appreciated how much he's added to her life. His intelligence and his kindness are a given.
But life with Peter brings exotic adventure. As a budding geologist, since a young age, Peter learned to camp and explore the outdoors in a way that is quite foreign to Rebecca. She will embrace the hikes and geological expeditions, but please don't ask her to sleep in a tent. And as she'll remind Peter, the bears, snakes, and even tiny spiders he has previously encountered on his digs are not interesting creatures needing a closer look, but mortal dangers. I know there's lots of stories. But there are safer excursions as well. Going to the Art Institute together, Peter's deep knowledge of and appreciation for art has given Rebecca a new way of looking at a picture. She will get an overall impression of a work, and Peter will show her how the artist got the fine details of composition just right, the paint on the canvas. Rebecca has told us how much she loves seeing things through Peter's eyes. And now with Peter's musicality, we can celebrate with happy birthday into and watch Peter grab Rebecca when they hear a favorite song and waltz her spontaneously around the kitchen and dance.
We have always felt that our marriage is a partnership, so we're here tonight as a duet. Peter and Rebecca have their own duet. Pick a book and read it aloud to each other in the evening. By this, they make what is usually a solo activity their shared pleasure.
So now, if everybody could
raise a glass to toast to Peter and Rebecca.
May you each join your distinctive voices in harmony, and may your story together be one of deep meaning, happiness, and fulfillment. We love you.
Being the youngest child, nothing you do is new. Your older siblings become the model for what you do, and at times what not to do. Rebecca set the bar very high, and of course I wanted to be just like her. As it turns out, we had very different interests, and I started paving my own path in true rebellious youngest child fashion, but the admiration never wavered. Rebecca graduated with honors, attended Yale Law, passed the bar with flying colors, and went on to work at Sidley in Chicago. Even when doing all of that, she always made it a priority to build relationships with the people in her life. She came with my parents to drop me off at college and visited many times when Noah and I lived in Cambridge. She was the first person I told when Noah and I got engaged and showered us with love and support. She has listened to countless rants about everything under the sun and has prayed for me and held me up in some of my lowest moments. She taught me the importance of family and being together, even when we don't always get along sometimes. She taught me the importance of having a relationship with God and being good to others, even when you might not want to. She has a heart for justice, loves fiercely, and puts God and family at the center of her life. So, Rebecca, it is so clear that you are living out God's plan for you. You have patiently waited for this moment. The moment you marry the love of your life. May God grant you all the happiness you could ever ask for, believe, or imagine. You deserve it all. You are my best friend, and I am so happy to be part of your wedding celebration. I love you.
Let there be heard the sound of joy and the sound of gladness, the voice of a loving couple, and the sound of their jubilance. Blessed are you who causes the couple to rejoice one with the other. We love you very much.
Okay, now if you all would bow your heads or extend a hand, however you like to pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity to be together and celebrate the love and marriage of Rebecca and Peter. Would you bless this space and make it holy? Would you make this a time of joy, fellowship, and sharing in your delight at these two people who are stronger together and encourage each other to grow in their faith and dedication to you every day? Would you plant a seed in every person here that they would support the two of them, offer guidance and prayers, and be a village to lean on anytime they might need. Lord, we thank you for this beautiful celebration, the food we are about to eat, for our music and laughter, and for our family and friends. May this be a time of deep encounters with your grace and goodness, and may we all go in peace when the time to leave comes. In your name we pray, amen.
Amen.
This is the most fancy group of people I've ever spoken in front of. So pardon me if I'm nervous. My name is Dave, and Peter's been my nearest and dearest friend since we were 13 years old. Or I was 13. I'm I'm going to start this off by saying that I cannot help but escape Trinitarian symbolism, and I will divide this. You asked for it. Into three parts. A recollection, a laudation, and a benediction. But a preface to the recollection. Really, the recollection's three parts. Wait for it. Any of y'all familiar with School of Rock?
Yeah.
It's a movie for the uninitiated where Jack Black plays a fraudulent music teacher who goes to this really pretentious middle school and forms a dopey little community of awkward preteens, and they compete in a battle of the bands. That was filmed at my middle school. I hated it. For 6 years, my mom drove me 12 miles from Queens to Long Island to Buckley Country Day School. I was miserable and desperately lonely, and I had no friends. And then I showed up at Regis High School. If you don't know Regis, it's where Peter and I and a bunch of people here went. It's an all-boys Jesuit high school. Our most famous alumni are Colin Jost and Anthony Fauci. So if you love SNL and hate COVID, on behalf of the Regis community, you're welcome. Here's a general recollection. Peter entered my life at a defining stage in my adolescence. We were placed in the same advisory group, and we discovered that we lived a few minutes away from each other, and all of a sudden I had a friend. And at the age of 14, Peter was dorky like me, and I think I remember some teenage posturing. Oh yeah, you like Jesus? Well, I go to magic camp. You go to magic camp, I collect rocks. It wasn't really with that tone, but that was, you know. But Peter embodied a kindness that I had not encountered before. And that kindness, in more ways than one, quite literally, in retrospect, I realized saved my life. Peter was a fellow among a community of guys who loved me into my humanity. He invested himself in me for all my weirdness and eccentricity, and I had never encountered that before. And as an only child, I sought brotherhood outside of biological lineage. And to this day, it breaks my heart into a thousand pieces that someone can know and love me without condition. And this is the lesson that Peter taught me, and in this he is an icon of Christ for me. Peter is, without hyperbolic cliche, and I think any other Regis guys here would agree, the best of us. And here is part 1C, the specific record. A decade after we met, Peter accompanied my parents and I to Syracuse, New York. We drove up because I was entering the Jesuit novitiate to begin formation for the priesthood. And we shared a hotel room before entering staying. For some reason, I don't know if you remember this at all, but we watched Marley and Me in our motel room. My parents were in the next room over. And toward the end of the movie, we're lying on our, you know, side-by-side beds, and Peter looks over at me and he goes, "Are you crying?" And all seems fear. He goes, "Sorry, messed the joke up." He goes, "Sorry, do you have glitter on your face?" In all sincerity, and I was crying. It wasn't glitter. And this is a weird recollection. I know this. And in my mind, it made sense as a segue into the laudation. So forgive me. Let me lavish some praise upon you, Peter. Look me in the eyes! You are strikingly handsome. You are unobtrusively charming and debonair, and over the years, Peter's a remarkable dancer. If you've never seen him dance, I have seen numerous women swoon and more watching him dance. No longer though, Rebecca, not tonight. More importantly, Peter is brilliant. He's a true Renaissance man. He's trained in photography and the hard sciences. He's a theologian. And he has this broad spectrum of proficiencies and technical abilities. And he embraces the life of the mind, but this is not what is most important. David Brooks, whether you agree with his politics or not, whatever, he's written about resume virtues and eulogy virtues. And resume virtues are what we put on our resumes. It's how we put food in our mouths, it's how we put a roof over our heads, it's how we go on vacation and drink wine and eat foods we like. But they don't matter because there are eulogy virtues, which are the things that people say about us when we are dead and buried. And these are what reveal who we most authentically are. And among his many eulogy virtues, which I hope I've hinted at enough, but Peter's joyfulness and unconditional kindness have defined our friendship and brotherhood. And these are what I care about. He will watch a sad movie about a dog and cry with you. More accurately, he'll watch a sad movie about a dog with you and watch you cry. And Peter, for that alone, I would go to hell and back for you. St. Francis de Sales said that there is nothing so strong as true gentleness and nothing so gentle as true strength. Let me repeat that one more time, because that's a deep shit right there. There's nothing so strong as true gentleness and nothing so gentle as true strength. And in Peter, these two virtues cannot be distinguished from one another. It is this purity that you embody, and that's what I love most about you. Now a benediction. From today onward, you walk with one another toward death. I don't mean to be a downer. There's a little subtlety in the vows today, right? Honor and love you all the days of my life. Not your life, because the inevitable truth is that one of you will die before the other. Remember whither you and we all journey. And we are all here tonight because of the choices you have made and the accidental circumstances you have found yourself in, and that is something to wonder about, right? That's miraculous. I don't believe in fate, because that strips us of our agency, but marriage is about your freedom. And so from here on in, may you recognize, name, and celebrate that your salvations are intertwined. May the quality of your love for one another manifest in the infinite beauties that pervade your existences, both in the events that freeze in your memories forever and in the daily, quotidian, unsexy, remarkably so things that pervade human existence. And when the defecation hits the oscillation, as my dad used to say, may you lean into one another with transparency and honesty, because crucifixion, and this is how we encounter suffering, right? It's through humor. Crucifixion will etch itself into the fabric of your existences in some way, shape, or form, leaving woundedness and scarring, and in those moments, in those seasons of life, you have a choice. That either poisons you, or you let it stretch your hearts in such a way that you are capable of loving one another and yourselves and those around you with unimaginable tenderness. And such experiences will be secreted away from human spectacle, known to you alone. And so may you not only have the courage to endure these sufferings,
but may you find difficulties to be charged with grace. May you be one another's redemption, and may you know the resurrection in each other's presence. This is where salvation is most potent in its most literal form. May you salve one another's woundedness, emotional, physical, spiritual, any and all of it, when you find your sainthoods in one another. And know that while you have vowed your lives to one another tonight, by being here, we implicitly vow our lives to you. We will celebrate the joys that await you and love you through whatever else the universe throws your way. Peter and Rebecca, I love you both. Let's collectively raise a glass to your relationship in the myriad untold ways that your marriage will generate love and goodness and light into our broken, beautiful world. Cheers.
Cheers.
Chosen to talk about Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 to 2. So, therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. And this is not going to be a sermon, but the cloud of witnesses are those who have gone before us as guides and who cheer us on as we run the race marked out for us. And so in that passage, the witnesses are mostly long dead people with beards like Moses and Abraham, or maybe in more modern sermons we talk about John Lewis or Desmond Tutu as the witnesses. But I don't see a reason that witnesses have to be dead. And in my cloud of witnesses, Rebecca is a big one. So Rebecca is a role model of intentionally pursuing good life in every sense. The pursuit of friendships that pull you towards who you want to be, of work that uses your many talents, and of a deep, authentic faith, and also of the good life, of the perfectly crafted scone or tour of Europe. And as I navigate my life, you pull me toward the good as well. So I remember when we both started grad school 6 years ago, you texted me that it was time for us to be bold together. And all through the 6 years since then, you've been helping me to go forward boldly as I start relationships, end relationships, think about leaving the PhD, and then finally, everybody, cross your fingers, finish. you have helped me to run with perseverance, the race marked out for me, by running beside me the whole time. And sometimes that's been very easy. You know, in college, it was pretty easy to go for our dog walks with world's best Shiba Inu. But for most of our journey together, it's taken work to make that happen. And you, above truly anybody else that I know the importance of showing up and investing in relationships with people that you love. And I'm so grateful for the times that we have shared together because of those investments. For our hiking in Montana and other places, for our dance parties in Connecticut and other places, and all of those things that you have helped me to make possible. And then even when we're not in the same place, for the hugs and the dog pictures and the blessings that you send me when I need them. So I'm so thrilled to help send you off today on the next leg of your race with Peter. I know that you'll show him the same kind of grace and dedication that you have shown me over these years. And Peter, I know that you know what a catch you have made. And while I haven't gotten to spend so much time with you yet, I know from the time that I've spent together how much you two cherish and balance and enjoy each other. So I hope that you will share many impeccably crafted meals, read alouds of good books, and a faith beyond yourselves, and that I will be there with this great cloud of witnesses urging you on. So I forgot my glass. To Rebecca and Peter.
From all different periods of our lives. Rebecca and I would love to thank all of you for being here today. And we have a few specific people we need to thank before we continue on.
We would especially like to thank our parents for everything they have done to raise us. And to make us ready to meet one another, and for all of the help and support over these months of wedding planning. We also want to thank our amazing wedding planner, Grace, who took care of things big and small and helped us enjoy not just this wonderful day, but also the planning along the way.
Now, our engagement was a very joyful time for us, and we'd like to particularly thank Tom Donnelly and Ann Wicker for accompanying us in our marriage prep. And not just them. Not just thanking just them, but all the family and friends who have poured love and care into our lives, shaping us into people ready to meet and love one another.
Many of you have heard this story, but my engagement ring was chosen by Peter's grandmother, Janine. More than 10 years ago, she took him aside and gave him a ring of hers in preparation for a future that she might not be around to see. And now I have something to carry with me from a person who I never met, but whose example of love and faith and prayer has helped make Peter the man that I love.
And similarly, my wedding ring was given to me by Rebecca's grandfather, affectionately known as Devin. Now, earlier this year, he was put into hospice. And since we've taken several trips to Little Rock, Arkansas together to visit, and seeing how Rebecca's grandparents have grown together in love and trust, particularly in their old age, was a vision to behold and an example for us to strive for in our marriage. And he gave me this ring.
So as we remember those who shaped us, who cannot be here today, and as we look at everyone here, the people we love most in this world, we just want to thank you all for your presence and for years of formative love and friendship. We can't imagine celebrating this day without being together.
And now, as everyone's kind of finished eating, let's dance. Thank you.
Yeah.